How many of you, by a show of hands, have done foolish things? Things that if you had to go back in time, you would not do them again. If you are sitting next to your wife or husband, it's okay not to raise your hand. Okay, how many of you have not done any foolish thing whatsoever? We perfect people. Okay, how many of you will not raise their hands no matter what I ask? Like many of you, I am no exception. I have done a fair share of foolish things. Growing up, I don't have the privilege of owning a PlayStation, like many of you do. Therefore, our kind of games were a bit unconventional. We would go to a building and a construction, stick our heads in through the glassless window grills, shout into the empty rooms, hear the echo, and we have a time of our lives. With my particularly small head, it went in every time. Oh, and to those with plus ice cranium, we can only watch and wish. However, one day, ladies and gentlemen, I met this guy called Murphy. Ever heard of him? Now, Murphy has a law. He said that whatever can go wrong, will go wrong. One day, I stuck my head in there. It refused to come out. I was stuck. My playmates tried all that they could to get me out. They poured water on me, at least they understood the concept of lubrication, and almost separating my head from the rest of my body as they could. But in vain. And after they ran out of wits, they fetched my father. Now that was really foolish. You may not understand why it was foolish. Let me paint a picture for you. Raise your hand if you have a disciplinarian dad. Put them all together, and you have my dad. See, my dad, his favorite African proverb was spare the rod, spoil the child. He even had a bookmark as part of scripture that says, for the son that he loved, he chastises. And he took that love a bit too serious. My father used to discipline us in advance. Whenever he's struggling, he would call us, order us to lie down, and he'd be thoroughly spanked. What have we done, he would ask.
Nothing.
But I know when I'm gone, you will do things. I'm just kidding. That was called creepy. He would travel, come back, and reporter in chief, aka my mother, would be waiting to report all the atrocities that we committed while Baba was away. And my father would forget that he beat us in advance. He beats us again. That was post-pay. We operated on a hybrid target. With that in mind, now you understand why it was foolish for my playmates to call my dad, right? And he came. Like any good dad, he responded to the SOS. Came and saw that his beloved son was stuck. Imagine what he did. That's right. He removed his leather belt. And as you can imagine, I was in the perfect position for failing. Imagine the temptation was overwhelming. I was thoroughly thrashed until my head came out. And that's the day I realized that sometimes in life, for us to achieve the extraordinary and seemingly impossible, what we need is the right motivation. And my father, in his own loving way, gave me all the motivation I needed to get my head unstuck. And boy, it did work. In the recent past, one of our local universities, Strathmore, decided to conduct a terrorism drill that went hideously wrong. And you could see students jumping from as high as the third floor of a building. And upon their feet, or whichever part of their body got to the ground first, touching the ground, they took off. Now, I may not rule out the possibility that maybe they have watched too much Captain America, but I think the real reason is that they had the right motivation. When they had the gunshots, it was a matter of life and death. If you went back to the same institution today and asked them to jump from the first floor of a building, they'd look at you as though you're crazy. The power of motivation. Let me ask, how many of you can competitively run in a 100 meters race? Well, I can't live for you. Everyone in this room can run 100 meters first. If a lion shows up at that door, the amount of untapped athletics talent in this room would be enough to command the attention of Athletics Kenya. How fast you run is dependent on what is chasing you. The only reason a deer outruns a lion is because it's really running for its dear life. See what I did right there, right? You know, Newton's second law of motion states that the acceleration of an object is dependent upon two variables, the mass of the object and the net force applied. In this case, the net force is a motivation. And in my not so long life, I have had the privilege of studying biographies and autobiographies of great men and women who left a mark while they were here, ranging from Nelson Mandela, Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, Hannibal, Alexander the Great, Mother Teresa, and our very own Wangari Maathai. And the one thing that they all have in common, besides the fact that they're all dead now, is the fact that behind their acts of courage was an even deeper rooted motivation. And I look at someone like Nelson Mandela. The oppression and the discrimination of his people served to him a great motivation, so much so that he was willing to endure 27 years in prison for the freedom of his people. And this is what he said. He says, I love this statement, that I have fought against white domination, and I have fought against black domination. I have cherished the ideal of a free and a democratic society in which men and women shall live together in peace, harmony, and with equal opportunities. It is an ideal for which I hope to live and achieve, but if need be, it is an ideal for which I'm prepared to die. The power of motivation. And my question to you is, what is that one thing that, if need be, you're prepared to die? See, at the age of 18, you haven't found that thing. Even if you live to the age of 88, guess what? You died at a very tender age of 18. And like these great men and women, I found my motivation when I was a very young boy, at age 16. Okay, well, that's not too young considering the ones I'm seeing here. Back then, my mother used to sell second-hand clothes somewhere in the east of Nairobi. And she had her vending booth by the roadside. And during the holidays, I would join her, help her in selling. But more importantly, I would buy myself in books. Because we grew up knowing that education is the key to success. Even if they change the laws, that's all right. But it's the key to success. And every day, a city council officer would pass by to charge to collect the daily levy. It was 50 shillings, that is half a dollar, every day, which was all right because you have to give unto Caesar what belongs to Caesar. But on this particular day, 4th of April 2004, like any other day, I was with my mom seated there, and this big guy passes by and asks for the 50 shillings. My mother had just opened a new bill and she told him, I don't have the money now, but go come back later, I'll have the money. But the guy said, no, I want the money and I want it now. My mother begged him, but I guess he had replaced, you know, there was an icebox where his heart used to be and he was hearing none of it. Then he did the next foolish thing, which they usually do in such a situation. He picked the clothes, put them in a sack, and he was just about to put it in the city council vehicle to take it to city hall. And my mother was literally tugging at his coat, begging him not to do that, telling him, I have a boy who needs to go back to school. This is his school fees and his pocket money. Please don't do this. And by that moment, I saw tears flow down my mother's cheeks. And mothers cry 3 types of tears. Tears of joy, tears of sorrow and tears of shame. And when a boy sees his mother cry tears of shame, that's a life-changing moment. I looked around, and I saw a slasher. I picked it up, walked up to this guy. He was a giant of a man. And I looked him dead straight in the eye. And I told him, it was typical of the biblical David versus Goliath. I told him, if you don't let go, I will dismember your leg from the rest of your body. I didn't know how I was going to do that, but I was determined to do it. And for the first time, the most reasonable thing, he ran for his dear life, like the deer. And I walked up to my mother. Now, my mother was shocked. She looked at me, she wondered, what happened to my son? He must have picked this from his dad's side. I walked up to her, and I told her, Mom, and I'm a man, and I'm all grown. I will work so hard that you will never have to beg any man for your livelihood. You ask me what's my motivation? That's it. That's what wakes me up every day in the morning. In pursuit of my dreams, I am a speaker, I write, I consult for organizations, and it's not always been easy. When I started off, it was difficult, and I've gotten to a point where I want to quit, but then I remember I made a promise to my mother that as long as I'm alive, all the holidays she sacrificed, all the good things she sacrificed that I could go to school, and all the shame she had to be put through for me to grow up comfortably. I have to repay, even if not all of it, because I can't repay all of it, I have to do all that I can to make her life as comfortable as it's humanly possible. And I am doing it right now. My question to you is, what is your motivation?